What's up, everybody? This is Robert again. I'm out walking again. It's a little bit windy, but nice and sunny at least. Rain's coming this weekend in SoCal. But for Easter weekend, happy Easter to anybody that celebrates Easter or recognizes Easter, I should say. And just to let you know, I want to talk about, you know, I've been talking about AFib and my issues with AFib, and I haven't talked about all my issues. I want to talk about doctors. Finding a good doctor is hard, okay? Whether you have to go to urgent care, primary care, ER, specialty care, whatever care you need, it's hard to find a good doctor. And my experience last year proved it to me. You know, when I got my gallbladder removed, I had to go to ER for gallstones and an infection. They took care of me. You know, they treated me well. They checked everything. They didn't try to stick any other operations that was necessary, unnecessary, I should say. They're just like, hey, you know, we might have to do something with your, go down your esophagus, maybe to get something, you know. They let me know possible complications as far as the surgery itself. So they did great. You know, the nurses are great too, of course. You know, nurses are actually do a really great job. You know, but doctors, you know, they finally discovered that I guess I had AFib post-op, and it was because of a nurse, not a doctor, which was great. I appreciate that, what that nurse did for me. However, it was like no one knew where it came from. You know, the Western doctors don't really work on the diagnosis of things, trying to figure out the cause. Most of the time, there's some things that they do, but a lot of times, you know, you probably heard it, they treat the symptoms. So, for example, you have a headache. It could come from a lot of things, right? It could be your heart, your stomach, nerves, you know, ear, like mouth. You know, there's a lot of places where you can get a headache. But what they mostly do is they give you Tylenol, aspirin, ibuprofen, you know, because it's to help treat the symptoms. So that way, it takes a little time to heal. Hopefully you heal, so that way they don't have to spend the time figuring out the cost. And I get it too. Like, I think insurance is an issue. They're not going to want to pay for all these tests, things like that. So it makes it challenging for doctors. Hospitals don't want you to sit in the bed every day when they could get another person in that. You know, yeah, sure, they're doing it for humanity, but it's about money too, you know. And you know, doctors, you know, I think they're stuck in between. Some of them are thinking, you know, well, we got to get them out, get this done, get another patient. And that's another thing. There's other people. There's lines. I'm not the only one that was sick. There's a lot of sick people, you know. And, you know, there's only so many beds, right? You know, like, remember COVID and how many people had issues with COVID and how, you know, beds were full, they didn't have enough staff, just they couldn't treat it, and or, you know, just like things like that. I'm not being political, I'm just being factual as far as space and you know, just room. You know, we need, you know, it's kind of hard. You gotta triage, right? And triage is another thing. You know, who has priority, who's actually dying versus not. But then again, let's go back, you know, finding a good doctor is really hard because maybe they could have personal issues. They could be busy trying to take care of other patients, focusing on other things, you know, and there's a lot of distractions, right? A lot of stress. You know, there's no doubt that they have a lot of stress. But then the ones in the practices, the ones that are not maybe in the ERs, the ones that are not in the hospitals might have a little bit less stress. I don't know. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a nurse. But I'm just saying, my experience, finding a good doctor, it's hard. When I was there, they had the second time to the hospital. First time was the gallbladder, like I said. 4 months later, I got sick and I had vertigo and I was like dizzy. And I couldn't stand up straight. And I was throwing up for 2 days, actually. And not just a vertigo, I was throwing up. Later on, I started getting double vision. Like, my eyes were literally crooked and I couldn't see anything. Started getting numb. My whole body was like numb. I couldn't start feeling anything. It was bad. I don't know what was it. And, it was good they did the routine stuff, did MRIs, check my brain, CT scans. They also checked my guts to make sure that was okay, no leakage from the surgery before, and a bunch of blood tests. But they couldn't figure out why, what happened to me. And, I was in the hospital 6 days. I ended up just leaving because I just wasn't getting anywhere. I'm like, why am I going to sit here? It wasn't about the money, my money or anything. It was just about, I felt like I was deteriorating. And they were giving me, medicine, to try to make me comfortable, which it helped. But I was still dizzy. I still was double vision. And, a neurologist came. And he asked me, he's telling me this, trusting me, making sure it wasn't like stroke results, like my hands and my arms and stuff like that. And I asked him, I said, what's going on? Like, why am I all messed up like this? And basically he said, I don't know. And I was like, okay, maybe he said, we don't know yet, but we're going to try to figure it out. But that was an answer. Just, I don't know. The main doctor in the hospital, same thing. So, you got any idea what's going on? No, we don't know. We don't know what's going on. I'm like, oh, great. And then, I couldn't even stand up straight, and I couldn't even walk. And I remember them giving me a walker for rehab. I'm like, rehab? I can't even stand up straight. What am I doing this rehab? What am I doing? How is that going to help me? I can hold myself up, but still not walking straight or anything, it was bad. It was so bad. Then the cardiologist decided to change my medicine because I guess I couldn't explain it because I was so messed up, but basically I have a slow heart rate anyways, maybe because of AFib or what, I don't know, but I have a slow heart rate. Like usually I'm resting, I could get down to the 40s beats per minute, and then 50. So they thought it was my prior medicine. And they changed my medicine, and I didn't make it worse. Like, I started getting, migraines. I never had migraines. It's bad headaches. It's bumping my head and everything. And then I ended up getting out the hospital, and then they're like, try different doctors, and one of them was like ENT. Go see your primary care, of course. And the primary care is like, well, you can try ENT, ear, nose, throat. I went to one that they referred, but unfortunately, I couldn't get to the doctor right away. I could barely call. And I was like, that's another rant. To book a doctor, especially a specialist, can take weeks to months. Months. I'm not kidding you. Doesn't matter what priority, because everyone's sick, right? And, this is horrible. But anyways, I was able to go to ENT, and I actually got a PA, physician assistant, not a doctor, MD. And, they're looking at me. I'm literally telling them, I'm sensitive to light. My eyes are literally crooked. Like my eyes up like that, not straight. Another one. And I'm just totally dizzy. And they're like telling me, it's like crystals in your ears that could be moving. I'm like, no, there's crystals in my eyes. It's not my head. It's my eyes, And they didn't even check my ears, It may have been something like that. I don't think it's anything in my ears, but I wasn't checked. Then I went to a ophthalmologist, just eye doctor. They checked my nerves, and they didn't find anything. They're like, well, we can't see anything in your eyes, maybe see a neurologist. So I'm like, okay. So basically, there you go. Your eyes are crooked, sorry. And you're seeing crooked. Then I called. I couldn't find a neurologist. The one they referred me, they didn't get the right referral. Oh, this is horrible. They wouldn't even answer the phone. You can't even answer the phone, which is fine. So you leave a message, never call me back. Never. Email them, never replied. I've been talking about a week, week and a half, 2 weeks. So it's not like, I don't expect minutes to get a reply. Okay, so my mom, which was 74 years old at the time, went to see them. And he said, it's the wrong referral. We don't help you with this. I'm like, great. What am I doing? And every time I went to get another referral, they kept on going to the same doctor, which is pointless because the doctor said they can't do it. And then I went to a cardiologist that I went to before. Now, of course, he couldn't tell me to do anything. He says, your migraines are not related to anything heart-wise. I'm like, sure. And then I'm telling you, I stopped new medicine a couple weeks later because it was just, what's it like thinking, one might do and my headaches went away. It stopped. They were bad headaches. They were like, I thought I was going to have a stroke or TIA, something like that. So I ended up, you know, just whatever. I'm sorry, I'm just getting a little tired here. And I finally found another neurologist after calling a few. And then I booked it with them. And that's when I started getting tinnitus. They're ringing in my ears, tinnitus. And what happened is that I went to see him, and I also had numbness. So I probably, when I went to the hospital, I started getting this numbness in my arms and legs, my neck, my head. I felt this weird vibes and stuff. And I was trying to tell the neurologist, like, hey, you know, I got this stuff, like the weird feelings. And he was condescending. And he knew everything. Doctor, so obviously he's smarter. I'm like, you don't know my pain. And he ended up telling me, basically, you know, my tinnitus is pain is in my head. I'm like, yeah, of course, because that's a neurologist. That's a brain issue, nerve, right? But he was saying it's in my head, like, I'm having anxieties. I'm overthinking. I'm stressing. And basically, either you can give me medicine or I can ignore it. I'm like, well, I really don't want medicine, because if it's medicine just to ignore the discomfort and pain, sure. But it doesn't solve the issue. It only treats symptoms, and not in a great way. And I was just thinking, hey, that failed. Whatever, I've been trying to ignore it, and everything was hard. So then I ended up going to my cardiologist again, when I told me it was anything he could do for a checkup, and I was telling him, hey, you know, my AFib's starting to kick up, and that's why I'm back here again. So this story, why I'm walking, my AFib kicked up a lot. And I go, here's my watch records. Is this AFib? And I did, you mentioned before, you know, they mentioned it could be sleep apnea being an issue. So I was like, okay, sleep apnea could be a thing. So I ended up doing a sleep study, and it proved I didn't have sleep apnea or any other things that could be the needing CPAP that could be causing AFib. Great news, at least, right? That's one less thing down. So that's good. And but it was funny, I had AFib during that time. But he was like, well, if it continues a lot, we can give you stronger blood thinners, anticoagulants, like Eliquis or something. I'm like, okay, you know, I'm taking baby aspirin now. I'm like, what is that going to do for me? He says, well, I keep forgetting stroke. I'm like, okay. But I didn't do anything except prevent me from having a stroke, but does it cure me or anything? No, you just, for a stroke. It's like, okay. So I ended up going to another cardiologist to get more of a stringent test. And you know, basically, you know, they want to treat the symptoms again, medication, and or an ablation, which only treats the symptoms and it doesn't cure anything. So, okay. What do I do now? You know, and that's where I'm at. And that's, you know, sorry for this long rant, but that's what I'm thinking, like, what am I doing? You know, what can we do with these doctors? You know, why were these doctors all different? You know, some of them, I think they just had big egos and they thought they knew more than you and this and that. Some of them, they try their best, but they don't know. So, I mean, we have our jobs and sometimes we do something that we don't know. You know, we make mistakes too. So it's a human thing too. So it's kind of like, you know, we need to find good doctors. And then the good doctors are probably taken, or not taken, but really busy, right? Because now you find a good doctor, you see some good reviews, good referral, and they're booked. They're booked for months. And then what? And you're sick. And you need some help now, but you can't do anything because other people are sick too. Fucking, why would you be in the line faster, you know? That's what the ER is for, right? If you're that sick that you're going to be, you know, near death, that's why they do that. But it's kind of like, okay. So it's just frustrating, you know? It's been a frustrating 365 days, actually, maybe 370 now. It's my 1 year anniversary when I got my gallbladder removed. I don't know if you want to call it anniversary, but that's when I got removed in March, and it's March, almost April now. So it's been a year. And then that's when everything went downhill, my health. And, you know, I'm so happy that I can walk, because I swear, like, last year, that was a point I couldn't walk. I couldn't see straight. I mean, literally, I couldn't see straight. It was double. It was crooked. It was horrible. You know, I had these weird surges in my body. Like, everything was surging in my body. You know, it was just weird, like, craziest stuff, you know? I lost hope almost. You know, and now I'm like, I still hate it. I'm still uncomfortable. I'm still in pain. You know, just the other day I was working, and then my manager was like on the Zoom call, we're on the team meeting. He's like, he talked to me later. Goes, dude, you look bad. Like, he didn't say you looked a little bit tired. You looked a little something. He goes, you look bad. You know what I mean? You know. I think you need to find a good doctor or do something for your health, man. You got to do something. I'm like, yeah, I know. But I just feel, it's just frustrating. It's just frustrating to do everything. And, you know, I try to be there and try to be, I'm not a big smiley dude, but I try to be not too gloomy, but it's hard. And, you know, I got 4 kids and I have to try to motivate them to do things. And I tell them every day, every morning, I take them to school or send them off. So I love you. You know, I love you. Dad loves you. But I don't know what happens. You know, we're not here all the time, you know, or we won't be here forever. We got an expiration date. What matters when, so we just have to do what we can. And that's what I want to do. I want to find, hopefully figure it out, this, all this crap, and heal to something better, you know, than I was, you know, when I was sick, or worse sick, I should say. Sorry, I'm not ranting now. But yeah. That's fine. You know, we got to find a doctor. We got to find a good doctor, you know, because this is crazy. Can't go on like this, you know. I wish, you know, you guys comment below, like, how's your experience with doctors, you know, have you had good ones? Have you had bad ones? Is it malpractice, things like that? You know, tell me your experience. But my experience, you know, I've had some good doctors and I had some crappy doctors. And it's been making me jaded, you know. And I almost give up hope. That's what I'm telling you. So anyways, thanks for watching. Appreciate you listening to my gibberish and rant. All right. Peace out, guys.